I had to sleep with the lights on that night. We clearly did not read the same book. We all know the saying, if you don't have anything nice to say, go post it on Goodreads. So today, I'm going to be looking at one-star reviews of three of my favorite books. All of these are books that I absolutely love and recommend, so will Goodreads reviews change that? Let's go get my feelings hurt. Oh wait, before we do, just a quick disclaimer. This is all in good fun, and I am not here to put anyone down for their opinions, and I won't be making any character judgments. Okay, now let's go get my feelings hurt. The first book is My Sister the Serial Killer by Oyinkan Braithwaite. It's a bit of a genre bender, but I think it really succeeds in thriller and psychological mystery. Goodreads rates it a 3.71, and I gave it 4 stars. Disappointing does not live up to the hype in any way. Overall, a book for people who don't read much. Short chapters, shallow content. Okay, first of all, rude. If you were hoping to learn something about Nigeria while reading, you also come up empty. A few foreign language quotes and descriptions of a handful of local dishes. Besides that, the book may as well be set in Paris or New Orleans. So what I hear you saying is that you learned something about Nigeria. Popular expressions, description of the land, local dishes. This book is masterfully written, but I hate it just about every second of it. The characters are real, complex, flawed. I would absolutely recommend it based on the writing. But you gave it 1 star. I would say this book was the equivalent of biting into a chocolate chip cookie and realizing it's a raisin cookie, but that would be insulting to raisin cookies. Wait, so we're out here protecting raisin cookies now? I picked this one up because many people were saying that it had a lovely sister dynamic. Who is saying that? One sister never stops complaining about the other one, and I mean, rightfully so, she is a self-absorbed serial killer, and the other is a serial killer who expects her sister to clean up her life's literal and figurative messes. And because the sister was a serial killer, we didn't see most of the action happening. Okay, there's literally a section a few chapters into the book that's like, she killed him on the first strike, a jab straight to the heart, and then stabbed him twice more to make sure he was actually dead. I mean, that sounds pretty action-packed to me. What are you looking for? This isn't directed by Michael Bay. If we had a POV from the sister as well, I feel like the book would have been a whole lot better. Okay, this one actually is valid. I do think the book would have been a little bit cooler if we got to see the other side a bit more. This made me question, though. How far would you go to save someone you love? Makes you think, huh? This was absolutely not my cup of coffee. Wait, that is not a real expression, is it? I mean, maybe this person just isn't that much of a tea drinker, and I love a good cup of coffee myself, but come on, it's just an expression. I didn't sympathize with a single character, and I came to find the main character even very whiny and cliche. Well, yeah, I would be whiny too if I were constantly interrupted from enjoying my day-to-day life because my kid sister had just offed another dude and I had to help her with it. Sorry, but this was garbage and a waste of money to read. Literally everyone in the entire book is an idiot and there is no sense of closure or justice whatsoever by book's end. Perhaps the author wanted to flip the script or something, but literally nothing changed from the beginning to the end of the book. When you end up right back where you started the book, with no character development or circumspection whatsoever, you're doing it wrong. That is brutal. Oh my goodness. Let's just go to the next book, please. The next book is Luster by Raven Leilani. And let me tell you, it makes me so glad I am done with my 20s. It's rated a 3.5 on Goodreads and I gave it 5 stars. I have no idea what this book was about. Well, let's just do a quick take to this next 1-star review, which will help you out with that. Save yourself some time. This is the plot of the novel. Black girl with daddy issues sleeps around, falls into a strange relationship with a white couple who adopted a black child. Strangeness ensues with a lot of nonchalant self-reflection. The writing itself is elegant and beautiful, however, it's just very hard to like the main character. She's just a meh person. So that is actually a pretty accurate description of the book. But I think there's a ton of nuance that's missing in this review, which makes the book really interesting. Not only does it explore things like race, kink, polyamory, and power dynamics, but it also covers topics like food insecurity, homelessness, transracial adoption. And they're all handled incredibly well, and in my opinion, not covered enough in today's literature. Also, it's worth noting that you can like a book without liking its main character. Those two things are not mutually exclusive. Simply put, this is the worst and most poorly written book I have read in years. It's a disgrace to the paper it's printed on. Not to the paper it's printed on. Ooh. Obama owes me $22.96 for recommending this. I really love this next one, which just reads, boo-hoo. 80% in and I gave up on this book. The protagonist seems so distant and annoying to me, and I haven't been able to connect with the story at all. Oh man, this one is hard for me to read because I personally finish every single book that I start, no matter how bad it is. Maybe I'm a bit of a masochist. And this person was so close to the end. I don't know where the author got the title. Nothing about this book has a luster. So I'm pretty sure this one is a play on words. Desire is very much at the center of this book. The main character is driven by lust, so you could call her a luster. This book annoyed me. It read as a debut novel written by someone who has taken some creative writing courses. If by some creative writing courses you mean graduated with an MFA from NYU's creative writing program, then yeah, you would be right. I was looking forward to listening to this book on audiobook because of all of the great reviews, but I must say I was totally disappointed in it. The narration was totally boring, and I found the book itself lacked luster. You know what? That pun was so bad, I'm not even gonna bother reading the rest of the review, so let's just go to the next book. The next book is Fever Dream by Samantha Schweblin. It is one of the most unique books I have ever read. It's rated a 3.7 on Goodreads, and I would have given it 6 stars if I could. There are a ton of 1-star reviews that just call this book weird, so we're gonna skip those, because it is. For me, the story was making the taste buds incapable to soak some flavor. What? Oh no, it goes on. To read this book was like eating something dry, chewing, and then puking out due to poisonous taste that could melt the flesh of the throat. I don't know. Do you know? I don't know. In all the entirety of the book, I was waiting for the point where I could locate some scent or some hint or link that could join some hidden structure. I can definitely see how this book can be confusing. It has a lot going on. For starters, it has no outside narration. The entire book is unbroken dialogue between the two main characters, Amanda and David. It toys with multiple timelines, but it mostly takes place in the present, which we don't know if that's immediately after Amanda is hurt and hospitalized, or years later, or if it even happened at all. I mean, this could literally all just be in her head. And that is what I love about this book, is that it masterfully builds tension. But it also forces you and I as readers into acceptance of the unknown, which is something that we're not used to in life, which is why we ask questions and try to find answers, and I definitely don't think it's something that we're used to in literature. I just don't understand how the small town would allow their children, livestock, basically everyone to be threatened, harmed, and killed by toxic sludge and leaky barrels. Seriously, no one would say or do anything to protect each other and their loved ones, not to mention themselves, not buying it. I have 2 words for you. Flint, Michigan. The reality of the situation is most humans are ineffectual towards environmental disasters, just like the characters in this book. Thank goodness this book was short, because it felt like reading words on a page with no meaning behind them. Not eerie, not horrifying, just a boring story that never went anywhere. Really? Because I had to sleep with the lights on that night. We clearly did not read the same book. This was like being swept up in the eye of a horrible, sweltering tornado. Uprooted trees and houses and dead animals are spinning around you. Rubble and sand are blocking your vision. Everything smells like storm and dirt and rot. I'm sorry, this person is writing this review and they sound like they spend all of their free time in the eye of a tornado, and I can't. I guess from the other reviews, this is supposed to be an awesome book. It is blissfully short, which allowed me to hate finish it without feeling like I wasted too much time. Hate finish? Oh my goodness, that is so good, and I have to use that. I definitely have hate finished a few books in my time. That's it. I can't take any more heartache. If you made it this far, leave a gold star emoji down in the comment section. All of the books that we discussed today are by women authors as we continue our celebration of Women's History Month. If you're interested in 3 more books by women that I'm reading this month, you can check out my very realistic March TBR right here. Yes, my reading list for this month only has 3 books on it. And yes, that is on purpose. Just meet me over there and I'll explain later. Thanks for watching and I'll see you again soon. I need to go call my therapist.